Welcome to St. John's Lutheran Church, Springfield, Ohio. Today is February 28th, 2018. This is our Wednesday evening Lenten service. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio. Our telephone number is 937-323-7508. St. John's has an outreach store open Monday through Friday, 9:30 to 1 o'clock, closed on Thursday. Food pantry open Wednesdays, 9 to 10:45. We have rainbow table every Friday from noon to 1 o'clock. Everyone is welcome. St. John's annual garage sale is coming up the first weekend in May. It will be Thursday, Friday, and Saturday. Members, or you can bring in your donations that we can put in the garage sale. Anyone would like to donate something, please bring it in. We're accepting items now. Lenten services through Lent are on Wednesdays at 2 o'clock and 7 p.m. On Easter Sunday, we will have a breakfast between the two services. First service is at from 8 to 9, and then with Easter breakfast starting at 8:30 until 10:15. Second service will be at 10:30 to 11:30.
Good evening. And welcome to our midweek Lenten service. Once again, we will be using the responsive prayer service, also known as the suffrages, on page 328. So if you have a hymnal with a ribbon, with the ribbons in it, you may wish to go ahead and mark 328. Also, our opening hymn, for those of you who read music, we will not be singing the tune that is on the page because that is an unfamiliar tune. Instead, we will be using the tune from hymn 611 in the background. But we begin by singing hymn number 332, I Heard the Voice of Jesus Say, but it's not to the tune on that printed page. So, 332, I Heard the Voice of Jesus Say.
Thank you.
come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. I believe God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Show us your mercy, O God,
and grant us your salvation.
Give us a joy of your singing, help again,
and sustain us with your bountiful Spirit.
Give peace in all the world.
Only in you can we live in safety.
Keep the nations under your care,
and guide us in the way of justice and truth.
Let not the needy be forgotten,
for the poor is taken away.
Create in me a clean heart, O God,
and sustain me with your Holy Spirit.
Lord, hear my prayer,
and let me cry come from before you.
The Lord be with you,
and also with you.
Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Heavenly Father, through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have graciously protected us today. We ask you to forgive us all our sins where we have done wrong, and graciously to protect us tonight. Into your hands we commend ourselves, our bodies, our souls, and all that is ours. Let your holy angels be with us, so that the wicked foe may have no power over us. Amen. You may be seated. examination of this 22nd Psalm and talked about the abandoned servant, we heard C.H. Spurgeon, the great evangelist, commenting on this psalm and saying, quote, "It is a photograph of our Lord's darkest hour," end of quote. And as we continue to examine Psalm 22 this evening, we see just how true those words of Spurgeon's are. As the psalmist years and years before Jesus' passion and death described what the Messiah would go through. Jesus hangs on the cross there, and there is no one to help. All the apostles except the one have fled in terror and are in hiding. So with that in mind, let us try to grasp the degree of Christ's suffering as he hangs in that hot Judean sun upon his cross. The first important point that the psalmist points out is that as Jesus is nailed to that cross and it is lifted up and placed in its position, that he says he is poured out like water on the ground. Water has no form. When we pour water out, it's just a stream and it hits the ground and then it looks for the path of least resistance. Unlike dirt or dust, which we can put our hand, add some water to it, turn it into mud and then make something out of it, or the same thing with clay or Play-Doh or sculptor's clay or whatever, water, we can't do anything with it but bathe in it and drink it. And water the lawn or fill up the swimming pool because it has no form. Well, in the Hebrew mind, this image of water means to be totally without help. The word poured literally means to spill forth, to pour profusely, to throw it out, to be a helpless condition. As Jesus hangs on that cross, he is in a helpless condition. There is nothing he can do, human-wise, to relieve the suffering. And because he is on that cross for the salvation of the world, he cannot use his divine powers to relieve his suffering. So he spills like water poured on the ground, which can't do anything to stop it. The water cannot stay within the vessel it is in. And what is interesting is that the psalmist uses this imagery of water when we remember that Jesus is the Lord of earth's water. In his ministry, we saw Jesus walk on water. In his ministry, we saw Jesus calm the storm, the waves of the storm, so that the sea again became almost flat like a tabletop, and the disciples could make it to their destination. At the well in Samaria, a Samaritan woman comes to Jesus, and they engage in conversation, and Jesus says, "If you knew who it is who was speaking to you, you would know that I could give you living water and you would never thirst again." And she says, "Well, Rabbi, tell me where this well is. You have nothing in your hands to draw water." And of course, she misunderstands that Jesus is talking about spiritual water, the thirst for a relationship with God, a thirst for peace and knowing that your sins are forgiven, that the spiritual assurance of forgiveness. And so Jesus is the Lord of water. But the psalmist uses that water to describe Jesus on the cross because it also represents a being in a helpless condition. The cross is a supreme example of the humiliation of Jesus. The water also represents for us God pouring out his love upon the earth in the form of his Son, Jesus Christ. God pouring out all that he has for the salvation of the world. We are all familiar with John 3:16. It's been called the gospel in a nutshell. share with somebody what Christianity is all about and just recite John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish but have eternal life. And that is the gospel. Our salvation is based on believing in Jesus Christ and what he did. What is sad, though, is that so many people do not know the next verse. Because the next verse, the 17th verse, is just as important. Because it states why Jesus came to earth. And it states why God sent him to earth. And it states what the true mission of the church is. Verse 17 says, for God sent his son into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. God sent his son, poured out his son on the earth, not to condemn the world, that the world might be saved through him. How many times growing up, or maybe if you grew up, maybe in Ohio you didn't have it happen, but growing up where I did, in the buckle of the Bible Belt, how many of you heard preachers growing up talking about God and the picture they painted of God? It was not John 3:17. And instead, the picture was that God sent his son into the world to condemn the world. You heard these hellfire, brimstone sermons that would scare you to death. By the time church was over, you were almost afraid to walk out the parking lot because you might get struck by lightning. Or someone gave you this picture of God as an old man sitting in a rocking chair just waiting to zap you for stepping out of line. But here we see that Jesus reveals to us the true God, our Father. That he loves us so much he pours his Son out to suffer the most humiliating type of death so that we won't be condemned, but that we might have salvation through him. So he is indeed the suffering Savior. The next point that the psalmist makes me want to focus on is when he says that all my bones are out of joint. Consider the pain of even one bone being out of joint. Fortunately, I've never had a bone dislocated. My oldest son, Aaron, played football, wrestled, ran track, never got hurt in those in any athletic competition. But as a sixth grader, in the spring, he was playing war with his two brothers, and he was running in our front yard. There was this huge ash tree in our front yard. And eventually, a person from the Kentucky, the Commonwealth of Kentucky Parks Department came and measured and said it was the biggest ash tree in Kentucky. Now, they do that with all the forests that are in, especially in eastern Kentucky, but they claimed it was the largest ash tree. Well, it had a big root that was above ground. And as Aaron ran, he tripped over that root, fell on his elbow in such a way that it dislocated his elbow. On the way to the hospital, every time there was a dip in the highway or it went over a bump or something, Aaron would cry out in pain and say, "Dad, please, can you make the ride, the trip easier?" And I tried. I tried to avoid every dip in anything that might jar the car. But he was in that much pain over just one bone out of joint. Here the psalmist is saying is Jesus was lifted up and that cross was put in its place, that in the jarring of it, and the awful position he was in, that it dislocated all his bones. And that was a possibility in crucifixion, that they could happen to the condemned. Out of condition is a Hebrew phrase that means, and so imagine this as your bones, to be spread out, so your bones spread out, to be parted, to be separated, to be scattered, or to be divided. Again, this is a Hebrew word picture to mean utter helplessness. Jesus is in utter helplessness. There is nothing he can do if he is to fulfill the mission of his Heavenly Father. Imagine the suffering as his bones are out of joint, as his sun, his hot sun is beating down upon him, as insects land on him, and he can do nothing to shoo them off. For some of the insects stinging him or biting him. Now we can understand or begin to understand the suffering of our Savior. Crucifixion was one of the most painful and humiliating forms of execution ever invented. It was so terrible that the Roman philosopher and historian Cicero writes that no Roman citizen was allowed to be crucified because it was a death considered too undignified and humiliating for a Roman citizen, no matter the crime they had committed. So it was reserved for those who were not Roman citizens. This is why St. Peter is crucified and why St. Paul was beheaded. St. Paul had Roman citizenship. And even though he was guilty of the same thing as St. Peter, being a follower of Jesus Christ and seen as an enemy of the Roman Empire, because of Paul's citizenship, his death is quick as he is beheaded along the roadside. One quick chop, and that was it, where Peter suffered for hours, like Jesus hanging on that cross. As Isaiah the prophet tells us in the 53rd chapter of his book, he was wounded for our sins and he was bruised for our iniquities. The suffering due to us was placed on him. Remember, Jesus is truly human, but he's also truly divine. He is the strong one, yet he becomes weak for our salvation. Remember when he was before Pilate, and Pilate asked him, "Are you a king?" And Jesus said, "You say that I am." And Pilate said, paraphrasing, leaving out some of the dialogue, but anyhow, Pilate says, "You know, what kind of answer is that? Don't you realize that had the power to release you or to execute you?" Jesus says, "That his power comes from God and there's nothing he can do." And Jesus says that his kingdom is not of this world. And that if it was of this world, his followers would have fought to prevent him from being handed over to Pilate. And then he makes a statement that, "Had I wished, I could have called down 12 legions of angels to rescue me." Normal Roman legion was 6,000 men, 72,000 angels and 12 legions. No one could have withstood that force. Jesus could have just opened his mouth and spoken, and all those at the cross could have been dropped, would have dropped dead. And he could have spoken and the spikes would have come out of his wrist and out of his feet. He would have gently come down from the cross. But that was not his mission. For Christ sent his Son into the world not to condemn the world, but that the world might be saved through him. See, God wants us to be saved. God wants us to be part of his kingdom. The message is so simple. Yet as we look throughout the history of the church, we see how many times throughout its history that there have been groups or movements or denominations that think they have to add something to that simple plan of God for our salvation. We know the story of the Middle Ages that brought about the Reformation. But are you also aware of what has happened since and how certain denominations, especially some that the shores of America have been guilty of the same abuse as the medieval church in putting burdens on the back of its followers that are not scriptural, that are not part of God's plan of salvation. As I said, you know, I grew up in the buckle of the Bible Belt. I grew up with a lot of fundamentalist churches around. I went to school with a lot of fundamentalist kids. And there are certain fundamentalist denominations where they had all kinds of rules. And if you violated one of those rules, you'd be excommunicated from that congregation or denomination. Things like you couldn't go swimming. You couldn't go to the movies. Not even a Walt Disney movie. I mean, what would be bad about seeing Peter Pan, Sleeping Beauty, Snow White, movies we grew up with, but that was forbidden. They couldn't wear things, they couldn't dance. In gym class, they couldn't wear the normal gym outfit for the that the girls were supposed to wear, even though the gym had a big curtain across it in half court separating the boys from the girls so that we couldn't see them. But they had to wear these long skirts and try to do athletics with that long skirt. That was to make them sanctified. That was to make them holy. That was to make them a true follower of Jesus. Yet here, we read that God said that to be saved, we only have to believe. That we believe that God sent His Son, not to condemn us, but to save us. That salvation is by faith through grace, apart from works of the law. And all those, of course, then I didn't even mention the last couple of prohibited, the things that are prohibited from doing, which in some cases some people would argue weren't bad. And that was, of course, no card playing, even if it was euchre or Old Maid or war or something. You couldn't play cards, you couldn't gamble, you couldn't drink, you couldn't smoke. Those are absolutely forbidden. But this is putting extra burdens upon the followers that Jesus does not put upon us. Believe. Believe in the suffering servant. Believe in the one who was poured out like water for our salvation, whose every bone was out of joint for our salvation, who was brought to death and was buried. That's what Psalms means when he says, you lay me in the dust of death, that is, to be dead and buried. Jesus died, was taken down from the cross, and placed into a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. His enemies pierced his hands and feet as they nailed him to that cross, believing that they were triumphant, believing that they had won for the status quo, having no idea that Jesus' death was not a defeat, but a victory for God and those who believe in His Son. And then to further humiliate Jesus, the psalmist tells us, they divided my garments among them, and for my clothing they cast lots. His crucifiers parted his garments and cast lots for his outer robe. This was traditional behavior. It was the tradition that the person being crucified, each person crucified was assigned to four soldiers. So there would be four members of the Roman legion when they were condemned prisoner, depending on how many were being crucified on a certain day. And those four then were entitled to whatever that prisoner brought with him to the site of crucifixion. Of course, most prisoners had been in the dungeon for days or weeks, whatever, so outside of the clothes they had on their back, they wouldn't have had much, but they might have had a nice pair of sandals or they had a nice pair of boots. They might have had a nice cloak or whatever, and that was what the soldiers were entitled to. So Reading that the soldiers were casting lots and dividing Jesus' garments is not something that was unusual. That was common practice. But what was unusual is when they came to Jesus' outer tunic, they couldn't find a seam in it. And so they said, let's not tear this. This is so unusual, let us cast lots. So they cast lots. Jesus came to clothe sinners with the robes of righteousness, while his enemies took off his robe and gambled for it. Jesus gives us the robe of righteousness simply for believing. His sacrifice brings us the redemption we so badly need and enables us to have that right relationship with God. Because God wanted the damage of our first parents repaired. He wanted us to be able to walk with him again. Not on this earth, which has been tainted by sin, but in his eternal kingdom. Seeing the suffering of Christ, gazing upon his tortured, twisted, and tormented body, how can we turn our back on his love? Seeing the suffering of Jesus Christ should make everyone come to repentance and to faith in the suffering servant. Amen. Peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus. Amen.
Steve Powers and Bill Corliss will take around the offering plate.
Let us pray. Almighty God of salvation, we pray for the members of the body of Christ. Send your spirit to those who struggle with faith, and let the faith of the church carry them in difficult times. We pray for all parts of the earth where seasons are beginning to change. Reveal the wonder of life in this transition, and give us knowledge and determination to care for the earth with reverence. We pray for all families, clans, tribes, and nations. Make them mindful of others affected by their deliberations and decisions, that peace and justice may benefit all people. Dear Lord, We pray for those who struggle or survive because of illness or need. Bless them with your presence and through the caring of those who attend them. God of Saul, we pray for children everywhere. Raise them up in your care, especially those who do not have parents or have neglectful parents. Show them holy parental love. Remember those who have died in faith and the goodness you have shown all generations before us. We pray that we may remain faithful, trusting the promises you have made. Into your hands, gracious God, we commit and offer whom we pray, trusting in your mercy, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. May the Almighty and merciful God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, keep you in his light and truth and love, now and forever. Amen. We conclude your service with Alas and Did My Savior Lead, hymn number 337, in the back of your worship book. Hymn number 337.
That concludes our Lenten service for February 28th. Join us Sunday. Worship service is at 8 and 10:30. Sunday school starts at 9:15. Again next Wednesday at 2 o'clock and 7 p.m. our Lenten service. St. John's is located at 27 North Wittenberg Avenue, Springfield, Ohio, and our telephone number is 937-323-7508.